Hi, everybody. Public comments, so we'll move on to the previous minutes. Terry just provided them to us. Any suggested amendments to the minutes? Motion to accept?
Motion.
Just comment, Terry, they continue to be excellent. Yes, thank you.
That's what we hear about it.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, minutes are accepted. Yes, they stand. All right. Chair report.
Rich forgot Jen's name.
As I was reading these, she kept referencing Jennifer. I'm like, Jen's. And I just kept reading, it's like.
You've got a lot on your plate.
Nah, that's bad. Come on, there's no excuse there.
All right, Andrew sent a note, an email to the mayor, NCC Rich, saying that he was resigning from the tree commission for personal reasons. So he's no longer a member, and we're down to six. He did say that he felt like we're on the right track. So I don't think it had to do with his dissatisfaction with being on the tree commission, as far as I know. I would have liked to have brought a card here for everybody to sign to thank him, but that and the tree watering tags that I wanted to bring are back in my dining room. So sorry about that. We can either do it next week, or you can empower me to make a card on behalf of all of us and just get it out. It's a matter of if you want it to be timely or if you want it to be signed by all of us. So that's that piece, and we will circle back to the question. Oh, no, let me just mention it now. So now that we're down to six, we're in this weird quorum state where if three people are missing from a meeting, we no longer have a quorum. Before it used to be four, and now it's three. Because three people missing means that only three people be present, and that's not more than 50%. So it's just a reminder that everyone's attendance is really important. I know that Jay has informed me that he's going to regularly need to leave at 5:45 every week. Is that for the long term, Jay?
For the fall.
And Jen has to leave at 5:45 today.
Yeah.
But otherwise, you know, I'd love for us to just do a check-in to make sure that the time commit we have made is working for everybody. Andrew was the main reason we were going to shift to a 4:15, 4:30 meeting, but now with him gone, we don't necessarily have to do that anymore. But anyway, that's just to everyone to please know that our quorum numbers have shifted over.
How soon is the flight what's the replacement process?
I have that on the agenda. Great question.
Okay.
And I feel like we should provide some kind of input in terms of the qualities we might have of a candidate we might be looking for. I mean, I know that there were more applicants in the beginning than there were spaces. Whether those people are still active candidates, I don't know, but whether or not, I think it's helpful a year and a half into this process for us to go, well, what are the sort of qualities that would help to round out this commission? So that's on the agenda. And then I don't have anything to say about the emergency watering tags. I just wanted to bring them to show you what they look like. We've actually decided, Rich and I, to hold a vote. I asked Rich and he suggested that we hold off on putting the emergency watering tags on now that we have some rain and the weather's gotten cooler. So they're just going to be on hold when the next drought hits us.
But they haven't rained?
Yeah.
Yeah, we can continue to water the trees, so that's 4 months. We're ready to
Yeah.
Unless there's
massive
rainfall, which I think you are chipped out of that this weekend.
Yeah.
On top of the hurricane, so it would be back in Florida.
Is it really?
Yeah. So I'm not going to get any rain out of it.
So that's it for my show.
Okay. Tree inventory is not one thing on it. So we had a kickoff meeting yesterday. With Davy Resource Group, which is the vendor that was awarded the bid for the tree inventory. I saw Zach out today, actually walking out on the periphery of Child's Park, not in Child's Park.
I assume they're not doing Child's Park, right?
No, they're just doing the trees on the edge of Child's Park. Liz McKinley is another certified arborist who's going to be working with him. She's in another project. She was there as well.
She was there too?
No,
she was
not. She was at the meeting, but she's going to Somerville. And then there's two other arborists. Presently, they're not here yet, so they'll be here the next week. So basically, there's going to be 4 to 5 certified arborists on the ground doing all this work. They are going to do a data collection, and they're going to start in the center of Northampton and the center of Florence, using those rings that we had set up to capture the planting locations. They're also going to use those to actually start the tree inventory work outward. Once they get to the 1.5 mile mark, we are going to have a discussion about, I would need to see how many trees they've actually captured to see where we stand with the 11,200 trees before they move on any farther. And then we also will see how many planting sites they capture if they actually capture 2,000. And then from there, we'll figure out how we're going to move out outside of that area. I'm working with one of the questions that came to me yesterday, which was a really good one, was Lily pointed out that part of that 1.5 mile ring is actually like Northampton Meadows. Mm-hmm. So, and tomorrow I'm going to meet with Andy Keith from GIS tomorrow, and we're actually going to take the maps we provided with them after you left, we provided them with those large maps. Mm-hmm. And we're going to actually highlight areas that we don't want them to actually do, which is known metal roads that are disputed, roads that really are just for, that really just have sumac, a lot of the things. There's really no, a lot of significant trees in the meadows unless you go near the edge of the river, which is not even on property. So, and then we're going to actually review the map and take off all the private ways so they don't have any trees on private ways. Mm-hmm. So we just got to try to limit trees that are in the public right away that have jurisdiction over. So the timetable I sent, yes sir.
if a subdivision is built and the trees are added to the side of the subdivision, but the subdivision remains a private way, those trees are not public shade trees?
No. City hasn't accepted a street yet, so I don't have any jurisdiction over it. So the deliverables will really be done probably the first week of November. So we're really going to have the whole inventory, supposedly all the data collection will be done by the first week. And they inventory, what the, how many trees?
The first week?
No, first week of November.
Yeah.
So between now and the first week of November, as the other arborists filter in, they will have all the data collection done. It's pretty amazing.
I can't wrap my brain around it, but I trust them. They have.
Yep.
I think it's because of all the work that Davey's done developing the software.
Yeah, exactly. They must, yeah.
And they're really ahead of everybody.
Exactly.
They are, which is.
They were delightful. I enjoyed being at the kickoff meeting. I felt very encouraged that we're in professional hands. Rich and I crafted a press release to send out immediately, just to let the public know to be looking out for these folks and to be excited about this new stage.
Is the press release been released? Is it somewhere?
No, Lily just emailed it back to me before we came. So I'm going to forward it to the mayor's office and ask them to incorporate it in the mayor's letterhead or however he wants to do the press release, and then hopefully it'll issue. Just so it gives, highlights what the inventory, and then I can read it to you if you're interested.
No, that's all right.
But it highlights, what the inventory is going to capture, who's going to be doing it, talking about the arborists will be, partially on, some cases on private property, any questions, contact myself. Talks about really the time, sort of the timeline, but it basically says that we're going to capture the data. Davey's going to actually incorporate it into a document that actually will be dumped into a urban forestry management plan. So just to kind of give the residents, a big picture of what, kind of zoom out, what it's really going to look like about a lot of minutia.
Maybe as soon as the mayor sends it out, you can forward it to the commission.
Yeah, I will just send it post on the blog. So, I was very happy with the meeting yesterday, and I followed up today with an email to Andy Holman, who's responsible for this contract with Davey Resource Group, to communicate with him about having access to Treekeeper. So Treekeeper is their software that Davey owns and operates. And Zach talked to us yesterday about they're updating our Treekeeper document in the field, so we can actually see them actually, the work, the data they're importing onto this Treekeeper, either on a real-time status or that evening, if they're not able to load it all up, they may have to get to all up. It's a big data dump, so they may have to get to a Wi-Fi place where they can dump it all into. But we should be able to, I don't know how many passwords they're going to allow us to have, but they will end up, so I'll be able to keep track of what they're doing as they're going, which would be nice because it will hopefully mean less infrequent meetings, which will take a little bit of pressure off of everything else I'm trying to manage. So I'm waiting for Andy to get back to me. So that was one thing that did my song yesterday.
In the existing map with trees on it? Without great detail, is that?
You mean the map that we have that is for the GIS map?
Yes, that has the trees with some depth information.
Yes, that is going to be probably put on hold for the moment. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Our maintenance man's on site. Do you mean the dumpsters are open for any reason?
Do you mean just to get out?
No, to get in. You can get out. Does anybody else need to get in?
No, I don't think so.
Once you go out, you can't get out.
Yeah, okay. All right.
Thank you.
Hey, Sarah.
So that'll kind of be on hold then.
Sarah, you're welcome to pull us.
That's going to be on hold because we're hoping to utilize, so Treekeeper is going to be able to provide us with a GIS layer of the inventory that we dump right into our GIS system. However, we decide to manage that afterwards is a larger conversation with IT. So, but yes, that will be on hold. We're not going to add anything to it because we're hoping to capture all the public shade trees, and I'm actually going to provide them a list of all the trees we planted in the last 2 years, so they'll be the same of them, including the setback plantings, they'll be on there as well.
Oh, really?
Yes, for this particular, for what we planted so far. So it's exciting. I can't wait to see the end result of it all.
Yeah.
Couple other things real quick. So we have a couple of public shade tree hearings coming up. One is at Coles Metal Road, Rock Ridge, for the Rock Ridge Deaconess. They have half a dozen oaks that they would like to remove, various sizes, largest one being 18 inches and smaller. They are required by the part of their order of conditions from the planning board was to build a sidewalk that runs from the corner of North King Street to their driveway entrance. So this unfortunately was something that they didn't, this was a site plan that was not, was approved prior to the significant tree ordinance, so it didn't, I was not made aware of it until the very end. They were told though that these were public shade trees. They should have, so they wanted to save them, they wanted to try to save them, and I recommended that they not save them, they actually remove them and replant them.
Because they're required to put a sidewalk in? So.
The sidewalk is so. So the problem is that the trees are so close to where the sidewalk's going to be built and their root flare and the root system will be disturbed so much that the trees...
How close are they?
They're right up, the flares are right up against the concrete. And the problem is that...
They'll go back.
Right, in order to get the correct pitch, they have to loam so many feet beyond the trees, so the tree would be basically like a telephone pole, so they would be... They would end up dying.
They use alternative sidewalk material,
like
the
curb and stuff? Not in this location. So that is an unfortunate issue, but I've been working with them to try to do a replanting plan. And I just received some information. They're planting a bunch of oaks. Basically, all setback plantings behind the sidewalk. Sidewalk doesn't go, it goes from Rock Ridge's driveway to North King Street. It means the other sidewalk that they were required to install along North King Street when they did their last visit, which was long before we had a significant tree ordinance. So, just an interesting, just that, you know, it's just the kind of things that I think we're still kind of working through. So, and then we have two other public shade tree hearings in the Village Hill neighborhood. One is in front of Fort Crossing. There are two public shade trees. One is a elm, one is a locust tree. They both have to be relocated due to the Pequoit construction project, which is Village Hill Circle.
Is this the co-housing project?
No, it's not the co-housing project. It's just these are single dwellings. So when you drive up the end of Village Hill, basically straight ahead, there will be another road with a circle with a panoramic home turn. But the trees are going to be impacted by the construction of that roadway, and there's another tree that's going to be impacted by a driveway. So those have to be moved. So the contractor is going to basically dig the trees up. They're young enough that I think they'll survive. And fall and burlap them and move into another location that's agreed upon, somewhere in the public right of way. So they're not going to be destroyed.
And they'll plant them, like, is there going to be oversight in that, you know, they just don't get dug up and put in a burlap and sit there for a month and then they put them in?
No,
like, it's like same day kind of thing?
They're going to have to be replanted within probably a week or one. There's just a fine little place there.
Yeah, sure. And I've like had experience with these type of things, and, you know, it's good intention, but they sit around for a long time.
It is good intention, but again, it's, you know, and if they don't make it, then part of the caveat that they're gonna have to replace it. So that'll be part of my...
What's the timeframe? If they don't make it, after how much time?
Well, if they don't make it this spring, if they don't come back in the spring, they're gonna probably have like a year warranty. I could actually do 2 years. They probably do a 2 year warranty rather than this one.
Aren't they required to maintain them to it?
No, this is different. Again, they're not significant trees. These are different. So if the significant tree ordinance doesn't apply to these trees, these trees are just regular old public shade trees that I'm responsible for.
I see. So what inch are we talking about?
One is 4 inch, the other one is 3.5.
It's not nothing.
No, it's not nothing, yeah. But I mean,
So they would really need like watering that first season.
Yep. Well, they're gonna need to be watered and be planted probably right away. Mm-hmm. And then I need to know who the arborist is that's actually gonna do the work. It's not gonna be one of the contractors.
I see CL Frank working up there a lot.
Yep. Well, CL Frank is the only one around here that I know of that is doing a lot of air spading for these contractors. So I've been trying to encourage any of the site plans that I've had to go visit with the developer or contractor. I've encouraged them to use CL Frank, Lashville, anybody that's around here that actually does air spading or does this kind of work, which has got a lot of certified arborists and a lot of experience.
So if we change that to 2 years, because I do think that, you know, a tree can like hang on but barely alive, but alive enough to be called alive in a year, then would you have it on your calendar to go back and inspect?
And the other public shade tree hearing on the same day is at Olander Drive. There was, I don't know if I brought this to your attention in the last meeting, but there was a resident that wanted to remove a public shade tree, and they were unaware of what the rules and regulations are in regards to MGL Chapter 87, so they had the tree basically all dug up. They were going to pluck it out and plant it on their own property and put a new, some... elm species. I don't know exactly what species they were going to use. And so we have to have a public shade tree hearing
to move it.
Yeah. And the resident was not very happy. Sent me a letter explaining that they felt that it was unnecessary and a waste of taxpayer money to do this. That's the law is the law.
I do have a question about that.
Yeah.
Does MGL consider moving the same thing as removal? It does.
It's either...
You're taking it off public property.
Oh, that's true. That is true. Okay, but what if you were to move it from one public spot to another?
You still have to have a public shade tree hearing. Actually, I can look it up and read it. Because I just went over this today because there's another issue about how we determine what are public shade trees.
That's another reason why we should call our legislators and encourage them to get this law changed.
Yeah.
We've had it for 10 years.
Does MGL specify the diameter of a tree that qualifies as a public shade tree?
1 inch.
Only 1 inch. So, hypothetically speaking, then all the trees that we planted on South Street that are probably not the best tree for the best location that we need to move, would we require public hearings to move those?
These moving
it says section 3 except as provided by section 5 public shade trees shall not be cut, trimmed, or removed in whole or part. So the answer to the question is yes. By any person other than the tree board or the deputy.
Oh, there you go.
Well, you finished though. Even if he be the owner of the fee in the land on which such tree is situated, except upon a permit in writing from said tree board. Nor shall they be cut down or removed by the tree warden, nor his deputy or other person without a public hearing. And said tree warden or his deputy shall cause notice of the time and place of such hearing thereof, which shall be identified, shall identify size, type, and location of the shade tree or trees to be cut down or removed. Or to be posted in the conservator's park or place and so on and so forth.
I don't think that's the spirit of the law. If we accidentally planted a tree in the wrong location, we want to move it and put another tree in that location, then it's still, there's still nursery trees. To have to then hold a public shade tree here?
Law and the law.
No, laws are up for interpretation. That means we have to get really clear about where we plant trees and make sure we get it right the first time.
How many trees are you thinking of?
I don't know, but I know that there's still a couple that are, you know, the columnar kinds. There's one down near like 80 something South Street that we never moved.
So actually, if you read this carefully, even if the EV, the owner of the fee in the land which such tree is situated, except upon a permit right for the tree. Nor shall it be pronounced, nor shall it be cut down or removed, so it's all encompassing. You have to have a public hearing.
Let's say you could give them a permit.
Right, but the permit is that after the public hearing has happened and there's no objection to that, I sign the document and send it back to whoever requested it, or I sign our own document. And I don't, we don't do public shade tree rings for trees that are hazardous.
Yeah, no, I get that.
There's a lot of companies, these are other trees that are more out, yes.
All right.
So if you make a mistake, you should correct it that day. What I would say. You recognize you made a mistake, or you recognize before you plant something that, whoops, this is a mistake, but you've got the wrong tree out here, and you shouldn't have planted it.
Well, I hope that's not going to prevent us from correcting our mistakes on South Street.
No, but I think it would have to be, we have to have a public shade tree here to move it. And if people object, then you just, all we're doing is moving the tree and replacing it.
Do you mind if we get some advice on the interpretation of that from our city solicitor? Because that just feels really almost ridiculous to me. If we planted a tree less than a year ago, but you know, the moment we planted it, we realized that it was in the wrong place, but didn't have the time and resources at that moment to move it.
Yeah, it's got to interpret the road.
There's no temporal segment of the definition of a public shade tree.
No, I can read that to you too, because that changes the dynamics.
Shall be.
Jay, you mentioned that 10 years has gone by and we should support changing.
There's a group of us got together about 10 years ago, Tree Warden Foragers Association, to rewrite Chapter 87, bring it up to date.
Yeah.
That was done.
Oh.
We submitted to the legislature, and they haven't acted on it.
Right. I want to make sure I move on to recognize Sarah Lavalle on the agenda. Rich, is there anything else in your report that you want to?
No, I think everything else is.
Well, hello, Sarah. I don't know if you know everyone around the table.
Most people, not everyone.
Okay. If you don't know Sarah, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Marilyn
Fisher. Rob Wilson.
Hi.
I'm Jen Warren.
Jay Gerard.
All right. So Sarah is has a double position in the city, right, Sarah?
Triple.
Triple. Yes. Conservation planner, the community preservation planner, and what's the third?
Historic commission. Also.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, no, Elm Street, so technically four.
Elm Street
Historic.
And what is your actual title?
Conservation, Preservation, and Land Use Plan.
Got it. Okay. So you wear many important hats. And you've been with the city for?
7 years.
And we asked you to come here today to basically just introduce ourselves to you, let you ask any questions you have about the kind of work we're doing. We can, you know, give you a summary or whatever questions you might have. And then also just talk to you a little bit about CPA funding.
Sure.
And what sort of qualification that our work has for CPA funding.
Okay. I think I'm pretty familiar with what you do. I work with Rich
I work with the people in the city quite a bit on public shade tree stuff. I work with Carolyn as part of planning board permitting and conservation commission permitting, which I also staff, so I'm familiar with some of the ordinances that you deal with, the important work that you do. And I put together just a one-page document sort of giving an overview of the Community Preservation Act and the Community Preservation Committee and the types of things that they do, and also some future possibilities regarding tree-related projects. So the CPA was established in Northampton in 2005, and it was reaffirmed again in 2011 pretty resoundingly when it came up for repeal. It's comprised of 9 members from the Conservation Commission, Historic Commission, Housing Authority, Planning Board, Parks and Recreation Commission, 2 mayoral appointees, and 2 representatives elected at large. And over the last 11 years, the committee has given out more than $15 million in CPA funds to all kinds of different projects, more than 100 of them at this point. All shapes and sizes, ranging from $3,000 to $1.2 million. The biggest project that the committee has funded so far is the Elastic Park. So eligible projects are in the areas of historic preservation, community housing, open space, and recreation, and those are established by the state law, but all funding recommendations are made at the local level. So I didn't give you details about affordable housing projects because that's less germane to the tree committee, but there's a little bit of an overview about open space, recreation, and historic projects, as well as I dug up just a few tree-related projects from other communities. Because of the limitations of CPA funding, there's a little bit less opportunity for specific tree projects than there would be for other types of projects, but there definitely is some opportunity there.
I have a question.
Sure.
So something like a streetscape restoration in a historic district, so the historic district would have to be
yes.
Like how many, is the only one we have Elm Street?
That's the only local historic district that mm-hmm. we have, but there's also additional National Register listed districts, which would make that eligible.
So
entire
the downtown?
Yes, all of the downtown.
Is?
Yes.
So just wondering, so the project could encompass sidewalk redo, like we were gonna say, oh, we wanna apply for money to put some new trees downtown. There could be sidewalk redo for the life of it, like to so the trees would actually survive?
Well, other communities have done that mm-hmm. because eligibility decisions are made at the local level. I can't okay. really vouch
no,
for
no,
the
I
eligibility.
No, totally no, I'm
but,
just.
But other communities me, have done
okay.
that.
Okay, that's my question. Yeah, it's not just for the physical tree stuff.
No, this one went beyond that.
Got it. Okay, that's my question. Thanks.
And this, I guess the predecessor to this committee actually was funded for a tree inventory
yeah.
I think 6 years ago.
They never
but yeah, the committee wasn't really well put together or formed at that point, so the money was just spent and was returned to the CPA. Mm-hmm.
Redo the sidewalks and fences. Mm-hmm.
And would that fall under recreation? What does that fall under? Is this all under historic?
The tree inventory was considered open space. Tree plantings on municipal properties. The ones that I found were historic buildings, but okay. the committees decided that was creating new open spaces. So that's the way that it was. Was funded there.
Yeah.
Some of these are a little, just because a community's done it doesn't necessarily mean it holds up to the letter of the law, but because all the decisions are made locally, then everybody can do it a little bit differently. And then removal of diseased trees from historic properties, that's a pretty common one across the state, where there's hazard trees that are causing damage to historic properties.
And are these public historic properties?
All of the ones that I was able to find were all public properties.
Oh, I see.
But that's not required. It doesn't have to be a public property.
It just provides for a public property.
It does.
And I know that our commission, at least in the past, has really looked hard at the level of public benefit that a given CPA applicant.
Yeah, absolutely.
And has turned away applicants that are improving public, like private properties that are historic but are still private.
Yeah. The committee has looked really carefully at the public benefit that each project provides, and there's absolutely no requirement that these all be municipally owned properties, and our committee has funded public, private projects, but they do want to see that there's an overwhelming public benefit.
Yeah.
Are there any restrictions regarding how many projects can be funded or within a certain amount of time?
Only the amount of money. So the committee has started a new funding round that's just beginning now. We actually have a meeting tonight. And the amount of applications that came in requested almost to the dollar what we have available for the whole fiscal year.
Do you do just one round a year though?
We're still doing two.
You're
not sure if we're
So you're saying that the money that's available now or the money that would be available the entire year?
The whole year.
So that the
Until the end of next year.
I see. So that if they were to award all that money, there would be no second round because there would be no money. And so is the CPA still pretty much drawing down all of its money year by year? Instead, like it hasn't created like a...
For the most part, there were a few years where they were building up a surplus, but that was expended.
And
all kinds of different projects.
And the other answer, or part to your question, Marilyn, I think this is still true, is that the money has to be allocated at least 10% to each of the three areas, the original three areas, which is open space, historic preservation, and housing. And then the remaining 70% can be distributed anyway.
Yeah, so each year the committee sets aside 10% of its annual income for those three project areas, and the rest is up for grabs to spend as the committee sees fit.
Have there been tree plantings connected to the historic buildings that were considered historic to restore what was there?
There have not. It's an application that is never put forward.
Okay. I mean, other than through the CPA, someone else working on that, like the museum?
Just generally? I mean, I know some private historic resources do a lot of tree plantings, but they don't really coordinate that with the city.
The city.
So much.
Other questions? I think this is a potentially really promising funding stream. I think we should keep this on our radar once we have our inventory done and we're prioritizing plantings, specimen tree care. You know, if historic district is broadly defined, then we're talking about a lot of territory, right?
Oh, absolutely.
Because historic district is not just the on-street historic district.
No. So it would be all of downtown.
Would it include downtown Florence, do you know?
Downtown Florence is not a district.
Okay.
But it could also be, there's sort of this catch-all that the Historical Commission can determine something to be significant to the history of Northampton. And they do that on a pretty regular basis. I don't think anyone seeking historic CPA funds has ever gone to the Historic Commission for that type of support and been turned down.
And, you know, my memory of what the CPA allows, it doesn't allow maintenance work, it only allows...
It doesn't.
So what about something like cabling a tree?
I would consider that to be protecting it from destruction.
Yeah.
So that seems like it
would be okay. Whereas yearly pruning or
that would help.
Yearly fertilizer.
Okay. That's the question I was going to ask. So if you receive funding and none of it can be, or is it even required to go towards any kind of maintenance?
Maintenance projects just in general across the board for even affordable housing as well, just aren't there.
So things can be constructed or built or repaired, but not, there's nothing set aside for maintenance.
So you could do extraordinary repairs if you're the foundation of a historic building is crumbling and the building is involved, and that would be allowable, but painting the shutters.
Community housing, is that a Northampton Public Housing Authority generally, or is it something else?
It could be that a housing authority property. I don't think we've ever actually awarded funds to the housing authority. It's always been private developers.
So what does that mean, private developer? I mean, what the private?
It's called community housing, but it's really affordable housing. So Valley CDC, for example, has submitted applications to create new affordable housing projects, and those are funds.
There are other nonprofit or for-profit or for-profit ones.
Yeah, a lot of what the housing authority needs is maintenance, and those projects aren't able to be funded.
Will those who are awarded be posted? Is it public?
Yep, absolutely. If you follow the link, and I can email this to Lily too, if you follow this link, it will take you to our website, and there's information about it.
Yeah, it's very true.
So you're the conservation agent as well?
Yes.
City? And is, in your work, have you run across any kind of challenges with public shade trees in regards to the Conservation Commission rulings or processes?
Yes. We've caught a few projects actually where people were proposing to take public shade trees down. And had they not needed a permit, they may have been just put in a tree down without having to work together.
Not needed a conservation permit?
Yeah.
They needed some permit.
Well, and then the driveway on the...
Where's that?
Massasoit?
No, that driveway process, the really steep driveway.
Oh, at 623 Kennedy Road?
Yes, yeah. Yeah, that wouldn't have been caught, I don't think.
No,
it
wouldn't have been caught. If they just came and got a regular driveway... Well, it would have been caught if they had come and got a regular driveway permit.
That's right.
But, yeah, there are cases where... There are cases where things go to CONSCOM and to planning, and then it is discovered that those are public shade trees, and then directly contact the Department of Public Works to deal with the issues.
And vice versa.
It goes both ways. And I think one of the things that we're continually working on is working on better communication and trying to find the right group, because there are just so many demands. So on my end, there's so many demands from people just asking for standard driveway permits that don't even go in front of CONSCOM or planning, which involve public shade trees. And then there's the whole process that planning and CONSCOM goes through to approve these different projects. And then those are also public shade trees become purview, or the information comes out in the open, and then we have to deal with them. Plus the significant tree urban. So there's a lot more communication than I've ever been, I can remember, which is actually a really good thing. So it's still, it's like a moving target though, still. We're still trying to refine it, I guess you could say.
So we've been talking about trying to find a way for the various boards and permit granting authorities to have a little bit more comprehensive review process, and like a permit flow through or what have you. And it seems like your office would be really good to work with on that, just in terms of natural resource protection.
Sure.
So not only public shade trees, but some of the work that you're doing with obviously wetlands and other natural resources, depending on where the city is and kind of combining all of that information. I think that was the initiative of the mayor, but perhaps, you know, there'd be some nice overlap there for us to work with you and create some sort of, you know, flow chart or charts about, you know, what people need to do when they start playing around with natural resources.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it's every permit is different, so it's kind of, you're playing it by ear, like, well, we need to do these things, so call this person and do this. But yeah, I think we can help applicants.
Yeah, just like, you know, I'm going to touch a tree. You know, is it here or is it there? And just like, just some really simple thing that you can answer. Before and start educating your own users,
etc. Sure, yeah, most of the projects that come in for wetlands and even historic ones sometimes do include some type of tree removal, and some of that needs reviewing, some of it doesn't, and I'm not even really clear 100% on exactly what would be needed.
I tried to read your zoning book, and I'm glad someone understands it.
There's a lot of it. So, when you do have someone come forward for permitting, and you know, is it fairly early on in the process that you ask, is there a tree involved, and if yes,
determine whether or not it's a public tree? Because we just want to make sure that now that we have Rich as our tree warden, that at the earliest possible stage, he's brought in on anything that has to do with public tree.
Yeah, it depends on the project. The larger a project is, the better it's, the applications are formed generally. A homeowner coming in thinking about a project might say, well, I know I need a wetlands permit because I want to do this stuff, but I don't really know about what else is happening on the rest of my property, and we may not find out that there's a tree proposed to be removed until much later in the process.
So is that something that could be corrected? Whereupon you automatically, or that the document, the application automatically asks, could there be a public shade tree involved in this project?
It's tough because we're obligated to work with state forms sometimes. It's always best when an applicant comes in and talks to staff first, and if that's the case, then we can absolutely flag that immediately. But sometimes people just think, well, I know what I'm doing and I'm all set. I'm just going to mail in the application and not talk to anybody. And for those projects, it would be a lot harder.
So you're required to use state application?
Yes. So
can you go beyond the state application form?
Yes.
I'm just wondering if we can get to a better place where we're never scrambling to catch up to the reality that because this project has gotten to, you know, stage D, we can no longer go back and fix the fact that a public shade tree is going to have to be in order for the, you know, but like that everyone's too invested in how far it's moved along.
Yeah, I mean, I can always flag it if it's shown on a plan. If something's not shown on a plan and the applicant hasn't thought about it, that's much harder. But we can always ask them to think about it. They may not have the answer until later in the process, and that's something that's, I think, a lot harder to fix.
What are your thoughts about that? Because I think that's
it's a very common problem in municipalities. I think. And you guys are moving towards an online, just work order system. It's not permit system.
We are working towards an online permitting system. We have one now. It's very clunky and does not suit our needs.
And the more integrated an online permitting system is, you know, the better and more customized it is to the actual laws of the municipality, the more things are going to get caught and triggered, and notices are going to be flying around, you know, ideally to people who, you know, need to see notices and be aware of what project is happening. But I would definitely, I mean, one big step I would encourage the city to do is just have weekly meetings to go over everything that's going on.
Yeah, and that does happen. The building department meets with the planning department once a week, and then there's other communities. And missing trees and possible hearings, I think, just doesn't just happen with trees. It happens with every type of application. Like somebody might go to the DPW for a trench permit or some other type of permit, and then later down the line, someone will go out and say, well, you're bulldozing a wetland, you can't do that. You should think about that. So it's pretty common. It's a tough thing to catch.
It happens both ways, though, because there's issues that I, for example, there's an issue that I ran into on King Street where I saw a contractor actually illegally disposing of asbestos pipe. So I immediately contacted the building inspector. Even though there's not a tree in sight, I just happened to be driving by and notice it. So it's a symbiosis. Mm-hmm. They work together. It's just that we're just trying to get better at it. Mm-hmm. I think it's really what it amounts to. I think it's just a matter of, a lot of people go to the building department and they want a building permit. They don't understand they have to have a driveway permit before they can have a building. They should build a permit before a driveway permit. So that's just one simple, you know, there's all these different rules and regulations. And I think with municity, that'll probably, hopefully, everything will be tied together. So when a person pulls a driveway permit, they're going to know exactly what they have to do.
Well, right now you have staff doing their best to hold together, you know, basically 70 years or more of band-aids and regulations on top of regulations, and it's holding this giant mess. And I think, you know, everyone's doing the best they can, but the city at some point has to take a step back and really put some money into updating and streamlining
the rules and regulations, bylaws and ordinances that kind of govern land use and permits, or, you know, it's just going to keep getting worse.
Yeah, so I guess, you know, our recommendation would be, I don't want to speak for the commission, so I'll just speak for myself, that in this application, it's kind of like when you, you know, when I do my taxes online with H&R Block, if I go this direction, they start asking me a series of questions. And that'll lead to more.
Have you lost $900 million?
And it seems to me like, because, you know, there's a state law protecting public shade trees, this isn't a municipal by municipal issue. This is like a statewide issue. We all share the same thing. Whenever there's a project that could affect a public shade tree, there has to be, you know, a public shade tree hearing if it's an open tree. So I would just love to, if the city is doing upgrades, and maybe this isn't a recommendation to bring to you per se, but more to your boss, but it just seems to me that we need to find a way to integrate this important question into the application process so that it's not discovered too late in the process.
Yeah, and hopefully the new system that we're getting will help us with that, because it's not just, is there a shade tree involved? It's also, are there wetlands involved?
Absolutely.
Are there, and
all
just so many types of questions.
Yeah.
And the more that somebody can say, oh, well, yeah, maybe. Oh,
right.
No, not that, then that will help guide them.
Exactly.
To the applications they actually need.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Sarah, thank you for coming.
Sure.
Thanks for bringing this important information.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah,
this is excellent.
All right.
Sure.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks.
Two
members. Do we have a
quorum? We still do.
Okay.
So, just following up, Jen, what you were thinking is that maybe apply for money to get structured soil.
Yeah. Instead of like in places that we root in downtown. You know, and it doesn't have to be the entire street. It can be, you know,
a few, handful,
five, you know, typical 3x3s, you know, like, you know, we can mathematically figure it out what it would mean, but, you know, a place like Florence, you know, there's some trees up there, you know, there's all these tree pits.
Although she said Florence is not his historic town, it's not a historic site.
Right.
She did say it was not historic, but it could be designated
as a significant public benefit site.
Yeah.
All right. Well, would you like me to put this on the agenda for next week to further explore? I do feel like we need to move on to other things on the agenda, especially because we have two people leaving it in 15 minutes. But 20 minutes. So, do you prefer? For further discussion?
How about in a couple of meetings later? Like
yeah, because later. We can't, it seems like we missed the window anyway. So, and it seemed like I had a lot of money being requested.
That doesn't necessarily mean that we'll give it all up.
Okay. Yeah, I definitely think we should revisit this cup, like maybe after more in like November or something like that.
Maybe try to get something in with it. When they do the downtown, incorporate that a grant in there to get structural soil for the sidewalks if the city's not willing to.
Well, I think also we have to work with Wayne and the transportation folks and the TIP you know, financing to make sure that, you know, that the redo of Main Street includes, you know, a massive redo of this shade tree streetscape.
Right.
Like a complete redo. Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay, I will put that on a future agenda. Okay, fall tree planting finalization.
So Rob and I have met today with Sue and Susan. So we are actually, I think we reported to you last meeting that Rob and I went to Amherst Nursery to look at the tree stock that we have purchased that's under contract. Following 2 days after that, or the day after that, Rob went and tagged all the trees that we were going to take. After last meeting, after discussion we had, we talked about planting 50 setback trees, plus planting the trees that were in our nursery that we had left, so we're roughly around 80 trees that we're going to plant. Tomorrow will be the day when DEP comes out with their water ban restrictions if they're increasing or decreasing. So pending whatever happens there, if we're good to go and we don't have an increase, increased restriction level, we'll be able to plant. So today, Rob has forwarded me two planting lists that are basically all the setback plantings, which are how many setback plantings?
That I forwarded were 35.
Right.
And I have another batch of 25 okay. ready to go.
So we'll be a little over the 50 mark for setback plantings, but I think with the amount of volunteers that we're going to end up having, I think it's going to work out well. The goal is to try to start planting, not next week, but the following week, which will be the week of the 21st, and there's going to try to do it in 4 days a week, and then I have to work out delivery arrangements for the trees to get from here. From Amherst to beer to be healed in our nursery, holding nursery, and then we will deliver the trees to a specific location that Rob will have volunteers like to take the trees from that. So I mean, I think we have a pretty good plan in place. I'm going to dig save all the locations tomorrow for the first list that we have. And then the other half of the trees that are we're not going to take will stay in Amherst.
And the vast majority of those are trees that will probably end up in tree belts.
Probably. So which will actually work out well because hopefully at the end of October and November, we'll actually have some preliminary data of where those 2019 sites are going to be. So if we end up having good weather, the potential is that we could actually have enough volunteers that we've managed to plant all the trees that we have with rough mammers. We could do some tree belt plantings for winter sets if possible. But I really don't want to do any tree belt plantings with the exception of the replacement trees from which trees died this past year or the already tree belt plantings that we agreed to last year, which is the trees that are holding that. So there's not going to be any new tree belt plantings until we get that list. So we're mainly going to do all setback plantings in honor of the tree belt plantings we have previously done or previously agreed to do. So roughly, we're still looking at about 80 trees, give or take. But that's all obviously contingent on the water infrastructure aspect of things.
And then after we have the inventory reconsideration of all tree belt.
Yep.
Questions?
I comment.
Okay, let's keep it brief.
Don't
make sure
your time. I'm always brief. One, two, I'm pointing.
As I said.
One, two, yeah. Three, four people who might be volunteering.
You're doing it before the election.
Or November 7th? Is that right?
That's the weekend before the election.
Oh, I thought, no, I'm asking, is that the
9th?
8th. Right, yeah, so after November 8th.
After November
8th. See you then. And others at the table?
Saturday morning is not.
Saturday's bad for you? Yeah.
Wednesday or Thursday?
Do I have time here?
Most of the time.
Yeah, probably better on days before
the two. I know. Take a new order then. Did you make a comment about your deal?
I did not.
That's right.
We'll
catch up. Okay, I just wanted to catch what was at the table.
Yep.
The other thing too is that we're also talking about doing another tree planting training at a time to be decided with all the players we have from last year and whoever else we determine will be leaders who for these different plantings. So if we make sure that they're all, again, we have a refresher course for ourselves, and then of course we have trained some new folks, so we're all on the same page and planting here correctly. So that was also a topic today.
There are three or four people who would like to, they have dug holes with before, they look like they could do this. And so I had suggested to them that Saturday morning might be a possible time, but I was wondering Saturday afternoon possible time?
Yeah.
This Saturday?
No, just trying to get it.
Yeah, what about during the week?
Wednesday afternoon?
Yeah, Wednesday afternoon.
Rob, maybe my suggestion just to kind of, so we got some, is to actually send out an email to folks and that you, some of us who want to be involved in this.
I've got enough of money. I need to make sure people were actually.
Doodle polls.
Yeah, but I want to make sure I can get respondents.
Yeah. Jay and I talked about,
right,
you know, we're having to run.
Right.
All right. Okay, so the vacancy on the tree commission, it would be ideal to fill it as soon as possible, especially because of the form challenges that it presents. Do people have thoughts about, and I have no idea if the mayor will even, you know, take our recommendations.
So really, when I got that email from Mary Ann, wanting a statement, she did indicate that there were other opportunities. There may be others.
Well, there were other applicants.
Will you be consulting on this?
Yes, I had an impromptu conversation with Mary about this last week, and he told me that he would be willing to, if there's people that we know that we'd like to bring forward, we encourage them to apply. Depending on the volume of people that apply for it, or the credentials, we may do either a telephone interview or do an in-person interview.
Okay.
Just like we did before. So I think the vetting process is very important to him, given the fact that there was the issue with the Human Rights Commission. So I think going forward, he's going to really vet.
Got a Twitter account?
So,
watch
yeah.
out.
Through your Facebook.
So he was definitely open. He's definitely an open book in regards to appointing a person. I told him we were going to be discussing this at the meeting to try to figure out, if any of us had any folks that we wanted to have on this commission, what kind of individual we're looking for, what kind of potential, what kind of experience. So he was very open.
Okay, good.
Is there any sense of what he might be missing or in need of in terms of expertise, interests, etc.?
I have a comment here. I think one thing that, there was a couple things I felt like Andrew really brought. One was he was, enjoyed and was experienced at grant writing. You know, he was really interested in that. And he also had experience, at a municipal level, I just thought, it was often helpful because he had, dealt with whatever.
Yeah.
The purchasing and process. And I mean, he just had information that we could have certainly found out, but he had pretty solid knowledge of boots on the ground in planting and, in various using municipal money and all that kind of stuff. Those were my
it's pretty, that's a pretty unique
yes,
job.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Yeah, you're going to be hard, I think you're hard pressed to find somebody that, I mean, you will find some of those?
The grant writing, I feel like I provide a lot of that between
the two. I think the experience that he brought to the head of municipal government, actually the contacts he developed and how to actually, he basically, in my opinion, really is galvanizing force to reforest oil. Mm-hmm. I mean, so one person, so he's made up a great amount of contact, so hopefully we'll be able to capture someone like that that has a sliver of that, mm-hmm. because it was really interesting to me, his knowledge that he had about how he went about getting things done, like as a single person, which is impressive. And here I am, I'm the highway superintendent, an industry warden, trying to move all this stuff. I'm like, I don't know how this guy does it. He did it. So,
well, I feel like the part that I feel like we're least adept in moving forward is the planning piece. Like, I'm really grateful for Todd's piece in that. And I feel like we could use another person at the table who's got that big picture planning perspective. I feel like we have a lot of boots on the ground kind of energy around the table, which I think is important too, but a little different, especially because we're starting to distinguish that can be part of a separate citizen operation, whereas our job is really kind of continuing to refine this so that we are making it easier for our urban forest to grow and be protected long into the future. So I don't know if Todd, you have any thoughts about people who have that kind of planning acumen experience?
Yeah, I mean, I reached out to the person I mentioned to you earlier about family commitments and stuff, but I don't belong to the Northampton Planning Club, so I don't know too many people, but
yeah.
Would it be worth reaching out to, the Sarah for one, and just kind of asking if she's aware of anyone, or our contact with the Massachusetts,
Molly.
Yeah,
this has to be
in Northampton City. I know, yeah.
Sure.
But maybe professor at one of the colleges teaching around natural resources or community planning or urban design or something like that, who has a wide array of student energy behind them. Conway.
His wife works out of town. He's got two little kids.
Northampton resident?
Yes.
So knows somebody about professor at he's in the rescue architecture regional planning. I'll contact him.
Okay.
Can't remember his name off the top of my head, but yeah.
Any other thoughts?
Rich, do you see anything that you would like to add?
It's like a loaded question.
I would emphasize that we need someone who has the time for this,
mm-hmm.
and who can attend the meetings that so we...
It's a big commitment.
Yeah.
We're the only commission that meets, I think, twice. We meet like the city council.
Yeah.
So we're twice a month, and we have a lot of moving parts.
Yeah.
So I think time is of the essence in a sense.
I would also just, put in there that I like someone who is comfortable working on a team, working through bumps in the road, when it comes to disagreements around the table, and who just in general has, a solid sense of process and communication skills. I think that those are really important basics, and without them, things can really get off track.
I think there's going to be a lot of big picture challenges coming down the road, especially if the city decides to follow through, for example, with all this proposed design to actually change the downtown landscape. So
Is that done? Is like the downtown design?
No, the design's not done, but they're using it as a way to get a placeholder in and add it to the TIP, which is a
7-year wait process.
But I think that's going to be a big picture challenge that will happen, and I agree with Lily and Todd that I think the planning, because what would be really helpful for me personally is there are a lot of boots in the ground. I have a whole crew that does a lot of work, plus we have this blossoming volunteer organization. What would be helpful for me would be to have someone have the ability to sort out all of the different ordinances and nuances that we have in the city government, how they, Todd's over there.
I don't know if you're going to.
You're probably not going to find that.
You got to throw some money at that. No one has time. I looked at it, and I would never sleep. It's a big task.
It's a big task.
The zoning ordinance and all the rules, it's a mess. I mean, you guys are hats off for dealing with it, but it, you know, it hasn't really been touched in a comprehensive way in probably, you know, 100 years.
But I mean, I think some kind of experience with that would be helpful. You know, I mean, even to get the conversation piece moving with trying to look at all those things and trying to have a comprehensive tree ordinance. I mean, that's key. You know, we have in the tree inventory, so we know all the trees we have. But to have a comprehensive tree ordinance that, you know, props up MGL Chapter 87 and streamlines the process and how we deal with public shade trees and trees that are, you know, significant trees on private property. Because I'm getting calls for everything, you know, solar arrays, trees, you know, tenants complaining about their landlord not cutting their, you know, having a dead tree in the yard, what can I do about it? It's like, holy smoke,
yeah. Talk to your neighbor.
I mean, that's kind of what I think. Respect everyone's level of knowledge, and also be able to work with everyone individually or as a group. Because I think that's really what's going to continue to make this commission successful.
Is Joel aware of anyone?
Joel Russell? I can ask him. All right, I know you two have to be going.
Correct.
Any parting thoughts?
I'll ask you.
The person you have in mind.
If you can't do it, you can ask.
Okay. Good.
It's pretty good. Here we
go. All right, we're going to pick you up both then.
Our meeting is, I guess, over.
No, we still have one. Okay. Yep. All right. Any other business not anticipated?
Can I just talk about two minor things?
Yeah, I thought of something too.
So our Arbor Day City USA program is again up for renewal as it is every year at this time. So we have till December 31st, 2016 is the deadline, which we have an online account, so I'm going to put this together. But I do want to contact Molly Freilisher and see if we are eligible for tree line. It's the other thing. She said that we're eligible to be Tree Line City USA, I believe it is, as well.
What's that?
I think it's related to how many street trees we have. I have to look it up, but I want to contact her.
So it's like a tier above?
It's a tier above it, and basically what it does is it allows you to actually, the more Arbor Day Foundation recognition you have, the more eligibility in the granting process. So DCR looks at this, and these, you know, if you're not a Tree City USA, yeah. You can forget about it. But as you move along, and you actually have more levels of recognition in the grant process, we actually move, I believe, to a different tier for any investigators that go on. So that's that's one thing. And the other thing is, I got a nice report back from Nick Rose from UMass Extension. They actually came to Northampton over the summer and took a survey of all the American elms on the list that I gave the public right away. So he did. They did actually sonic tomography, which is a non-invasive inspection, really using what looks like an MRI of the inside of the tree cavities. So unfortunately, the tree that's on the corner of Henshaw and Elm, which is a
Is that Helen Hill's?
No, that's the one on the other. It's in the tree belt. It's right in the corner right there. It's
very tall and thin, right?
Very tall and thin, yes. This tree is actually, if you drive by, you can see it has a lot of tip dye back. But it also has, after he went and did one sonic tomography, he decided to come back because he wanted to do one more lower down on the trunk, more towards the base. And he actually found, just to summarize the results of this, the lower trunk of this American elm was harboring a significant amount of decaying wood from pathogenic fungus. This decay appears to extend into the outer sapling, based on the images from 25 cm, which may explain the canopy dieback. However, other stresses are likely involved, as well as including this year's drought and restricted root zone. So please keep in mind the tomography results of this one are a hazard tree risk assessment. So this is what they could consider a level 3 hazard tree risk assessment, which is could also be used if you have used an existing graph. Just an interesting document that is available to us. This is actually able to do this for a fee if we need to have trees evaluated, if I can't determine the soundness of the tree. What I thought was interesting, because I'm going to get a report on the rest of the elms.
How many?
12. So this is the elm that he found to have. The rest of the elms that he surveyed preliminary are very healthy, except for the one that's in front of the historic Northampton, which is now dead from the Dutch elm. Just interesting.
So it looks at the trunk?
Yeah.
Were those 12 trees all being treated prior to?
Yeah, treated.
Or not?
10 of them.
10 of them
are, yep. Yeah. In the process, we discovered a few other elms that were actually city trees that I didn't realize they were driveway permits. We got a couple down at Plastic Park. It was in the back of the bank in the far corner that was a tree that had grown straight up, but it had like a 22-inch DBH.
And it was an elm?
Yep, American elm. But it was actually probably a shrub elm. So it wasn't planted on purpose, it was accidental, right. But yeah. It's amazing how large they can get in that form before they do it.
Is there a difference in the expectation of what they'll grow into if they're a shrub elm?
All right, we don't have much.
Well, I know it makes you nervous when I speak.
No, I'm sorry.
It does. Every time I do, you get nervous.
We'll get over it. Because it's not the topic. And so I just want to make sure that we're keeping, because we want to make sure we wrap up our to-do and get out on time. I'm aware that at 6 o'clock, we have to be done.
That's great.
So I apologize. And I will be conscious of not cutting you personally.
I thought it was just interesting. You might want to know that those kind of things are going on behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Available to us, so.
All right.
But we can talk about it after.
Yeah, that's good. That's good.
I did want to just say one other thing with other business, and that is I just want to make us aware that the deadline to submit an intent to apply for a DCR grant passed.
Yeah.
So we are not going to be able to apply for any money this year. So we just want to keep that a little bit higher on our radar, because I think that it behooves us every single year to dip our hand into that pot. Why not? Even if it's just for something smaller like support with the watering program. But we're not going to do it this year.
No, but I think it's kind of, in a sense, I think it's kind of okay, because I think we need to see what how the inventory pans out, and maybe that'll give us a definite, that'll give us a great tool, I think, to actually utilize to show the mayor and the council that, you know, this is an ever pressing, very important issue. These need to be rectified. So if we don't, this will allow us actually to probably apply for ACR grants for the maximum amount of different types of tree work.
Yeah.
And different types of plants, so. I don't know, I think we've bit off a lot in this last year and a half, and I think what we've accomplished is by, is much more than I ever thought we were going to get in a year and a half, so.
So when's the next opportunity to apply?
1 year.
1 year, so October 1st of 2017, you have to have your intent to apply letter into DCR. So that'll give us all a year worth of thinking about what we, what kind of funds we want to corral from.
Yeah.
A particular reason, one reason.
Well, and we could, you know, we could do a combined CPA, DCR, where we have one match the other.
What I found interesting was that I realized that we could actually get CPA funding for Caleb and Solar Trees. I never knew that. So that is actually, we're spending probably $4,000 or $5,000 a year in Caleb trees. But I find in the, you know, they're not all in storage, but they are large mature trees that have a lot of value left in them. So a little bit of Caleb is
good. Any other business?
I'm still working on the the one-page annual report, and I know that you're busy with canvassing, but I'll get that.
Okay. All right. And I have not yet approached the city council and mayor about making a presentation to city council. So I'm putting up that on my to-do list. Any other things that you captured today for to-dos?
Oh, for to-dos, yep. Let's see, just a few. Rich, tree inventory is beginning. Tree planting is beginning of October 23rd. And we're working on the Arbor Day, the Tree City renewal. Speaking with Molly about whether or not we qualify for a tree line city. Rob is going to do the tree planting schedule coordination. Volunteers. For the new candidate outreach, I have Jay and Rich reaching out to folks, and Lily press release to the mayor for the tree inventory.
Yes. Okay. Motion to adjourn?
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Adjourn.